I'd like to take a minute just to appreciate this book that's sitting in front of me right now. This is a copy of the Latin Bible, printed by Anton Koberger between the years 1486 and 1487, and it contains the commentaries, or the postillae, of Nicholas de Lyra. And as you can see, it's printed in a two-column Gothic font with the commentary surrounding the biblical text, which is given at usually at the center of the page. And throughout this book, you will find some illustrations, some woodcut illustrations that are in fact the earliest illustrations ever to be included in a Latin Bible. Also throughout the book, you'll notice that each page has been hand rubricated in red or in blue, and sometimes individual letters with red and blue combined. It's a beautiful object, and it was produced in a world before mass production, when each book was in many ways a unique artifact, because each book was a product of many hands. And today, as I sit at my desk with this book before me, I'm reminded of the world from which it came and the journey that it has traveled to arrive here in my hands over half a millennium later. It was a world before Columbus, a world when the church was yet to be fractured by the Reformation, before the rise of nation states as we know them today. It was a world that must have seemed smaller in some ways, but also much larger as well, because it was filled with so many uncharted territories, undiscovered lands. There were so many mysteries yet to be unraveled. It was a world governed by monarchs and the church, and these held sway over vast territories, and the daily lives of people were shaped by these institutions and traditions and customs that had been passed down to them across generations. This book was created in that distant world and would have been a prized possession of its first owner, probably a member of the clergy or an affluent scholar. Its contents would have been eagerly pored over, studied, discussed, debated in the halls of academia and in the chambers of ecclesiastical power. Over the centuries, it may have passed through the hands of many, each one carefully preserving it for the next generation. Otherwise, it wouldn't be here. So its survival is a real testament to the reverence with which it was held by all those people who owned it across the centuries. The process of its creation, as I mentioned, would have involved many skilled hands. Craftsmen who made this paper by hand from rags, and the pressmen who operated the printing press, pulling the devil's tail to create the impression. The compositors setting all this type individually. And then, of course, the rubricators who meticulously added the red and blue lettering by hand, bringing the pages to life with color. Each one was a master of his trade, and each one contributed to the creation of this book. And booksellers and publishers played a crucial role in the journey as well, often underwriting the financial costs and the risks of the printers. Contemporary purchasers and readers also played a key role in perhaps not its production, but in its survival. This book was valued not just for its content, but for its glorious craftsmanship. So each person in the chain, from the craftsman to the bookseller to the reader, played a vital role in the life of this book. Despite the vast gulf of time that separates me from its creators and all those who were its stewards across the centuries. I feel somehow that we're connected by the shared experience of holding this same physical book in our hands, the experience of turning its pages, the experience of finding meaning in its words. This book, with its handcrafted pages, is a testament to the human desire to create, to preserve, and to share knowledge. For me, it's a link to a past that may be gone, but is not forgotten. It's a reminder of the enduring power of books to connect us across time and space.